We're joined today on Magic Book Club by a very special guest, a very famous author, John Green. Hi, John.
Hi, it's so nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
And today we're going to be talking about your book, Paper Towns. Do you want, for people who don't know, do you want to tell us a bit about it?
Sure. Paper Towns is a story about a guy named Quentin who lives across the street from a young woman named Margot Roth Spiegelman. And he's always romanticized her and idealized her and wanted to be with her. And after really not talking for 10 years, suddenly she shows up in the middle of the night in his window. She takes him on this crazy all-night adventure through the streets of Orlando, Florida. And then suddenly she disappears. And Quentin decides that he must go on a quest to find her.
They're very sort of different characters. Do you want to tell us a bit about Quentin? Because it's through his point of view, isn't it?
Yeah, Quentin is a, Quentin is someone who has his whole life mapped out. And that's kind of one of his ways of dealing with anxiety, I think, is, he knows what he wants out of the world and he's just trying to get it. He often says that his life is boring, but that he likes boredom.
And Margot.
Margot is extremely spontaneous, and she's one of those figures who seems larger than life, but her last name is Spiegelman, which is a German word that means mirror man, and so much of the time when people look at Margot, they don't see anything about her, they just see a reflection of themselves, because everyone is always sort of projecting their own experiences and their own thoughts onto Margot instead of letting her be a real person.
Yeah. So how did you get into the sort of the mindset of the teenage boy? Did you sort of go back to your youth?
Well, I mean, I never know if I have done a good job or not. But, I do think a lot about my own teenage years. But I also think that, some of the experiences, the experience of falling in love and grappling with grief and asking big questions, like those aren't unique to teenagerness. It's just that when you're a teenager, they're happening for the first time, so there's an intensity about them.
Yeah. And what I like about your books as well, they haven't really always got the conventional ending, the kind of ending people expect. Is that kind of what you sort of aim for?
Well, I like slightly ambiguous endings because I feel like that's kind of how life works. I know that's one of the pleasures of stories is that they don't have to be like life, and my stories often aren't. But, I guess I want to tell the truth, and I believe that the truth is always hopeful, but I also believe that the truth is always complicated, and sometimes things don't work out how you expected or how you dreamt, and sometimes you don't know the answer to questions that you really want to know the answer to, but we have to find ways to live hopeful lives, even though that's true.
And where did you get the whole idea for the Paper Towns sort of thing?
Well, Paper Towns are basically fake towns that are put onto maps by map makers to protect their copyright, so that if they see their fake town on someone else's map, they'll know they've been robbed, basically. This has been going on for thousands of years, and Google Maps still does it. It still happens all the time. But I learned about paper towns because of a paper town called Holin, South Dakota. Holin, South Dakota. Now I get that it was a pun, like hole in South Dakota. I just happened to be on a road trip with my girlfriend at the time, just after college, and she and I came across a place that didn't exist, I guess. We were driving past a town called Holin, South Dakota, and there was nothing there. And then we looked it up later, and it turns out that it was a paper town.
Because it's amazing how you sort of map out these clues that Margot leaves. How did you come up with all of that?
A lot of I hate to confess this, but a lot of the plotting was done by Sarah, by my wife. She and I take a lot of walks together when I'm working on the beginnings of a story, and we kind of get ideas together. But she is a brilliant clue weaver and revenge inventor, so she definitely had a lot to do with that stuff in Paper Towns. But it was just fun to think about interesting clues or metaphorically resonant clues to try to kind of be Margot for a while.
So it's actually going to be in cinemas. How has it gone from the book to the film? Was that an easy process?
Well, it wasn't an easy process for many years. So this book came out in 2008, and shortly thereafter, I wrote a version of the screenplay that was unfortunately very bad. I am not a good screenwriter, and Yeah, it would have been a terrible movie. I'm grateful in the end that it didn't get made. Then many, many years later, Nat Wolff and the producers of The Fault in Our Stars and I were all on the set of the movie together, and we started talking about the idea of making a Paper Towns movie with Nat as Q. And I got lucky enough to have the same screenwriters who wrote The Fault in Our Stars, Weber and Neustadter, write a beautiful, brilliant adaptation of it. And from there, it went very, very quickly, and here we are.
So, because Nat was obviously, he played Isaac in Fault in Our Stars. Have you got a good relationship with him then?
Yeah, Nat's a really great friend of mine, and I mean, we maintained our friendship after shooting The Fault in Our Stars, and then through the weird process of publicizing it, and then even afterwards, and so our friendship isn't limited to movies, which is nice, but yeah, I trust Nat so much. He's such a brilliant actor, and he's a very generous actor as well. He goes out of his way to make sure that everyone else gets he makes everyone around him better, and I think you really see that in this movie. Like he brings out the best in everyone he works with, and I just feel very, very lucky that he's been in both films.
Yeah, and obviously you've got as someone who we don't normally see in films, you've got Cara Delevingne in it as well. Did you have much to do with the casting?
Well, I think you're going to see Cara Delevingne in a lot more films because she is a really wonderful
She's
actor.
fantastic.
Yeah, she's so good. I didn't have anything to do with casting. I mean, I don't cast movies. I'm not a casting director. I don't know how to cast movies. All the actors and actresses who I think of when I think of teenagers are now like 38 years old. So I'm totally unqualified to do it. But when I saw Cara's audition, I agreed with everybody that she was an amazing Margot. You know, she just has this intensity and energy and eccentricity about her that's very rare.
And do you think, have you found that it's, has it stayed true to your story?
I feel like it's a very faithful adaptation. I mean, there are things that are different, but the most important thing to me is the preservation of the themes and the characters and the feelings in the story. And I feel like in that sense, it's an extremely faithful adaptation. And I'm so proud of the movie that Jake Schreier, the director, and this whole cast made. They're so it's just it's it. It just feels like a huge gift to my book, so I'm very grateful.
Because I thought with Fault in Our Stars, it was that last, that transpired so well onto the big screen.
Yeah, I mean, they did such a great job, and a lot of that is, you know, having Weber and Neustadter write both scripts. They really respect books. But with this movie too, it was the same as the last time. Like Nat and Cara and everybody in the cast really cared about the book, and they really cared about the readers of the book. And there would be lots of times where they would come up to me when filming and ask about what I was thinking in a scene, or did I think that this kind of change would be okay with readers and questions like that. And
Because when I spoke to Ansel last year about Fault in Our Stars, he was very passionate about the book.
Yeah, I mean, he loves the book, and you know, Nat Paper Towns is Nat's favorite of my books, so he felt very, very strongly about it. Really wanted to play Q, and you know, there was never a world in which he wasn't going to play Q. But you know, everybody, I mean, like for instance, Austin Abrams, the guy who plays Ben in the movie, Ben in the book plays the clarinet, and even though he doesn't play the clarinet in the movie, he learned how to play the clarinet just so he would understand Ben better. So that's the kind of cast that we had for this movie.
Because he was fantastic in that film. He really is.
He's awesome. I mean, he's yeah. It's funny. I mean, I knew he was going to be great when I was watching it be shot, but when I saw it in the movie, I was like, "Wow, Austin is amazing." Yeah. So is Justice, the guy who plays Radar. I mean, the whole cast is great, but I find those three guys hilarious.
And also, Ansel pops up as a cameo in the film. Are you going to be doing this in lots of others? If you do any other adaptations, have you reoccurring characters?
I don't know, not my decision.
And we just like talk very, very quickly, just to wrap up the interview, a little bit about Fault in Our Stars, because it was a big favorite for us on Magic Book Club. How did you ever see the massive success that would happen with that book?
No, I mean, I never imagined that that book would reach so many readers or that it would be commercially successful. I thought it was quite sad, and that you know, people wouldn't want to read a book that was that sad. But it felt like a book I really needed to write and wanted to write. And I'm completely overwhelmed by the response of readers to it. I mean, I think readers have a choice how they read. You know, we can read, we can skim, we can read ungenerously, we can look for things that we don't like, or we can fall into a story and take the good in it that we can find. And I feel like readers of The Fault in Our Stars and all of my books have done that, have been extraordinarily generous to my work. So, yeah, I just want to thank them for that.
I mean, it was probably one of the most moving books I've ever read. I sat on the train once, literally crying, and someone had to ask me what was wrong. They were like, "Are you okay?" and gave me a tissue. But I just thought that, with the film really what stayed true to the story. But was there a reason why you wrote the book then?
I mean, there were a lot of reasons. I've always been interested in grief and especially in like illness and disability and how we find meaning in life when life it can be circumscribed by disability or even be shortened by illness. I worked as a student chaplain at a children's hospital when I was much younger, and I think that was probably part of it. But also I became very good friends with a young woman named Esther Earle in the last couple of years of her life. She died of cancer in 2010 when she was 16. And you know, my friendship with Esther inspired a lot of Hazel, not necessarily the physical challenges that she has, but Hazel's empathy, her extraordinary gift for kind of understanding the feelings of those around her, and also just the way that that Hazel tries to, I guess, tread lightly upon the world, tries to minimize the suffering around her. That was something that I saw a lot of in Esther. And
well, thank you so much for talking to us, John. It's brilliant. This will be our Book of the Week. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks for making it the Book of the Week.